allegories for our consciousness. So some people have an intuition of that, and they see they need an element of pressure in their life. In the past, we will search for a master that we can totally trust. And that master role was to bring an element of pressure in our life so strong, and because of the love, that we would embrace this pressure and transform. Is an old methodology, very ancient tradition. Today, it's not like we're gonna look for a master, they all disappear somehow from the 3D. They are all in other dimension. They still guide us, and we need to remember this galactic dimension of us, that we are not just that part of us that is trapped in this physical body in the 3D. We are much more than that. So, but those who cannot see this, and there is millions of people on this planet, they are now, they came knowing that this time is a time of collective initiation. We all gonna go through a pressure. And we cannot misunderstand the time. If you fight against this pressure, the level of frustration will raise a level of anger that will make you go in the street. And this is not the way you're gonna solve it. Anger is never a way to solve. It just release your steam, your pressure, your inner pressure, but then you lose it. Do you understand? Pressure needs containment. When you keep that's what the coal under the pressure of the earth cannot run away. There is no exit door. There is no way to escape. And I guess now, and as this time is now, we are at that threshold, at the portal, entering for at least, I think, next year, this increasing of pressure and the increasing the speed of our transformation. So it goes together, yeah? So we need to understand the time and not go against the time. So the focus is the key. I already said it the last months, the reality you create for yourself, you are totally, totally responsible for where you live and the reality you are in. And according to where you focus, not only the attention, but your intention, what you want to serve, what you want to, what is the direction in which you want to act? You know, what is your value? What has a value for you? Instead of, you know, rebelling or complaining or reacting to all that is not functioning, and this is going to be more and more dysfunctional society. So we cannot continue to try to explain what happened to us as it would be a conspiration plan. You know, it's not a conspiration. A master is a trickster. It's not playing around, but he wants you to understand there is a need for pressure to transform. And if you understand the time that way, you will welcome the pressure in your life through, you know, can be relationship, can be in the family, can be everywhere, in your job, or in losing your job, or many, many ways the pressure will enter your life. And it's not the time to fight against it, but whatever you are losing, whatever needs to be transformed and will explode or disappear, or something will happen in a totally unexpected way that is not necessary in your favor as you see it. So the first attitude would be welcome what is there and how come this can serve me to elevate. Because your focus is now definitely on your body of light. In our level one, we introduced these seven bodies, you know, fundamentals, body of energy, and then eventually When you start to understand that the concern is not what about me, but rather what about us? And now it shows every the history. This COVID pushed us to see that we are solidar. This planet is one humanity. This is not races and countries and borders. We are one humanity, and we are all interconnected. So it's so essential to live in that consciousness. This is not a philosophy. Everybody feels it now. It happened all over the world in the same time, the same kind of struggle, same kind of wave of fear, anxiety, and rebellion, and anger, and frustration. So these are the demons, these are the temptation for darkness, you know, where you, anybody can go there very easily and think, oh, these guys, they manipulate everybody, they want to make money on our back, and all this conspiration theory. It doesn't help you to grow a very strong, positive, and proactive attitude. The new man is you, and it is already now. So don't expect it will be tomorrow better or different. I'm not selling you any hope. You are today, based on your choice, the new human, or you are obsolete. When you offer yourself to fight, to react, to be angry and frustrated because things do not go the way you thought they should go, drop it. Drop it. This reactive personality is based on 2,000 years of history through your genes. You know, you have Akashic memories and you have genetic memories. It comes through lineage and it comes from different incarnations you had. And now you carry this memory that is activated for everyone. And this is, if you attach to be dependent or honoring your past, you're not able to live in the now. So that's what the ancient master predicted. The time of now, the time of this Kali Yuga, is time of Tantra. Tantra means now. That's why I also changed my speech. Is time is now. Now is not tomorrow. We don't have the time to think about tomorrow, and we don't have to waste the time with what was yesterday. The question is, now is the only magical moment in life, and I have to learn that I can be empowered to make this life just magic. And magic is not mystical magic. Magic is just to see the beauty of life every moment, be with it, connect to it, and promote it, develop it, share it, communicate it. There is tremendous power on this planet, yeah? Enormous power. The power that rotated this planet within the solar system, within the galaxy. Can you imagine this masses moving? How much power is there? And this is all coming through our different bodies. So we need to choose. Are we serving the energetical body and trying to survive and to live, make our living? Or are we here being of light, contributing, co-creating to what is that solar system? What is this planet supposed to be? And what is humanity is supposed to realize? So when you choose to be concerned by the us rather than by the me, first the anxiety of me will go. Then you have a big space open for new frequencies. So of course we often say time is to rise your frequency, and it's definitely true. I believe this. But we have an image in the 3D of high frequency are people, you know, super excited, super joyful, super activist, integrate the stress in a positive way in your life and justify that you can just run faster. This is nonsense. This is not what is high frequency in terms of yoga, in terms of what we practice together. Yoga brings to a stage what we call samadhi or sat-chit-ananda. Sat-chit-ananda, that's the mind is totally established in truth. He doesn't look for answer because he has no question. So it's very relaxing in the mind. And then your physical body express, experience, feel bliss, ananda. Ananda, this is rooted in peace. We have to focus on what balance, equanimity is that the opposite, the pair of opposite come into such equality that at the end, it is totally peaceful. So as long as we are not looking for peace, and you know, from this life extremely busy, we have been trained to be producer, to be effective, to be people who have result and analyze the result by quantity, by dollars, by kilos. So this is how we estimate who we are, how much zeros you have on your bank account, you know, how much you can produce in such a short time. That's what we call efficiency. But if we look the result of that level of efficiency, which is totally unconscious, we have totally abused and raped the planet, and we are now facing a time where in the next 100 years it will be really hard to survive on this planet because of the condition and the consequence of our unconscious efficiency. So the shortcut is really definitely stop. And that's what I have experienced myself in my own life. I was not aware how much I run, how much I run after good things. Even that is not necessary. It's to sit down, to breathe, and to realize it is here, it is given to us. And the stage of peace doesn't have to mean boredom. For most of us, when we start to meditate, we find the space sitting in a square meter and not moving for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 31 minutes. Then we feel totally nervous, anxious, distracted. We look everywhere. The mind goes berserk. We are upset. We are frustrated. We go through all these stages by sitting and just watching our breath. Yeah. So you see how far we are from just being and existing into the space of peace. And if you want to access bliss, the first step is peace. We just can't enjoy the nature of life if we are running, if we are already in the future, or if we are running away from the past, consequence of the past. So we are now in a crisis of evolution. And this is not for the future. This is happening now. And now is the time to access the meditative mind. That what bring these two tendencies, the left and right, the sun and moon influence, into an amazing balance, like a clock. You know, the solar system is a giant clock. Everything happens exactly at the time it has to happen. So the equinox is not 10 days late this year, and next year will not be 5 days earlier. It is just in the exact time. So there is a sense of time, but it is beyond time because it is unlimited cycle. This universe move in the extremely harmonious movement. Everything is regulated and totally balanced. And we put ourselves off by our busyness, you know, by our stress, by our impatience, by our mind running horses. So practice meditation. And the most simple is to fix your attention on your breath. Realize that the rhythm of your breath has to slow down. I already said it, slow down your breath. Do this few times a day and welcome peace. Focus on the peaceful feeling, the peaceful space. Yeah. calm down. There is no reason that people make you believe that there is a pressure, that you have to run, that you have to pay, that you, nothing like this. Take your time, breathe, settle down, and become an island of peace for yourself. It will be also tangible by everybody around you, and not just the people living in the same place. It is also all the people you're connected to that will benefit from this wave and frequency, high frequency of peace that we can emanate, radiate. When you are totally body, mind, and speech peaceful, you affect the universe, you contribute to create this universe in harmony, in resonance, and in peace. And that's what we are asked to today. Change gears. If everything seems to go faster, just sit down, breathe, and bring this peaceful experience to yourself. So, regularly reflect on your level of frequency. When you're facing the void or the emptiness or something you have lost or something that seems to be a secure environment all of a sudden fall apart, connect within. The outside cannot destabilize your peace because the peace is who you are. The true essence of the being of light you are cannot be shaken. Yeah? When you connect to this matrix, to the original waves of who we are, which cannot be transformed and changed and broken down, then the outside world can be anything. It will not destabilize you, who you are. So remember, we are being of light. This is just a bunch of photons that create this illusion of a physical body that seems to be so real. But when you connect to your essence, you will be much less under the pressure of the outside. So this is a must. I was teaching, and I will teach again on meditation in the level 2 in Russia, through Zoom, of course. But this is the beauty today. We can be in different places in the same time. We can connect to each other in a huge circle of peaceful human, and we can inspire each other to maintain that frequency. So it is a time of initiate the direction, but with action, with really make decision. What you decide now, it will last until 22, which is definitely the heart of the chaos. In the next 3 months, it's gonna increase in many levels, in many direction in our life, where what was harmony before, what used to be our secure and safe place, this will be destabilized from the outside world. So if we are welcoming all these things crumbling down, more void, more space we can find to elevate. And the same as the pressure transmute the quality of the crystal, if we use that pressure not to exit and run away, but to really transform, then we can start ascending to a more spiritual frequency of existence. That means totally cutting bonds with what hooked us down here in the 3D, and just be most of the day in the 5D or 6D or other dimension. Realize we are being of light, and we are workers of light, and we just share this light. This light is not a passion for result, is not running after dollars and efficiency. It's about the quality of being human, an enlightened mind, an enlightened being who share a breath that is in resonance with the rhythm of the universe. So this is definitely a month to cultivate balance, not neutrality, because it's not to hide and step back and be neutral. It's to be active, it's to really move into action, but by choosing exactly what value you want to see in this world and start to manifest them. It's not just choosing. If you choose love, you need to manifest this love in your daily life with everybody, and not as a philosophy, because time is now, and now is the time to be this new human, not waiting that the context change, that it will come from outside or a government or something. No, it's coming from individual. We need to empower ourselves and realize the only power there is the one that goes through me. That's the one I can manifest. And I am not powerless. It is totally free. This world is free. Of course, if you're anxious, you're gonna see yourself limited. If you see yourself as a being of light, you see yourself unlimited. It's the same reality. It depends how you look at it. So maintain yourself as a highest elevated frequency, which means maintain bliss and peace. For me, this is the two value, measure value, that will help us to go through the next 3 months in a better way, the best way possible. That will make you ascend and use to your advantage the pressure that is in the environment. So it is a time to initiate new things. And for me, it came very obvious after coming back from almost leaving this planet. That school that you all connect, this Amritnam Sarovar, is an amazing spirit that is born more than 20, 30 years ago. And it was following already a creation that was not so international, but more like in France at the beginning. So it became Amritnam International because we start attracting people from all over the world. And this is the Sarovar is like the grail, you know. It's a place where this water is so clear that everybody can come and drink one drop and be inspired. That's the symbol of the school. And of course, I used to be a servant of a master and really dedicate my life for 35 years, totally be under the umbrella of this Yogi Bhajan master, and I have met and served other masters as well. So Kundalini has a sense for me expanded and extended. So when I left in 2016, the institutionalization of this yoga, I think yoga cannot be institutionalized. Yoga, it's really a way that is absolutely traditional. It is very precise, but it cannot be put in a box. The origin of this teaching, they come from the Akash. So nobody can pretend that I have the copyright for this teaching, even though it comes through channel of specific teacher. Then they come and go, but these teaching are always with us. So for me, the teaching are not crystallized 40 years ago, and they're not the property of a handful of people who manage this in a business way. But the access to the living teaching is through group consciousness today. So this I saw, and I saw it at the very beginning. So my intention in opening that school space was to transfer the experience of the living teaching through group consciousness. And I think that's where I'm stepping in. Since 2016, yeah, when I cut from all the bond with this institution, I was driving the boat a little bit where the wind will carry us, and intuitively, but with not exact perspective where to go. So I didn't take any decision. I just study a lot in depth. What is our foundation? What are the fundamentals, teaching, and the matrix on which we lean to spread the teaching and offer people the best experience possible and actualize this experience in a humanity that is changing? So I took the step not to repeat the teaching as they have been given 40 years ago, but to really change the speech and see what is the situation today, what human being needs today, where are the priority, and how can we use Kundalini to awaken the man of today. So this was my option, and I could see that this can be propagated and spread it through a group of consciousness. So group consciousness is a few people who sit in a circle and decided to speak honestly, directly, and be open to show their shadows and not have the strategy to avoid, to hide, and have a double speak through the double tongue. So when you are able to receive feedback from somebody that is honest and direct and express exactly what he feels, you can receive that and you can give that. And this mutual reflection actually makes you grow by the acceptance that in me there is a resonance, and in me there is a way to access my own limitation. There is a way to turn around the strategy of our shadows who want to stay in the shade. They don't want to reveal. So the path we choose is called the path of light, is bring your shadows into the light and have the courage to see them honestly. So this is a radical change from the way we receive the teaching. You know, 40 years ago, nobody would think of any transformation and changes. And the master says he came to create teachers, and I did this for 35 years. Today, I think this is not the time to create tons of teachers. There are too many teachers. People pretend they have teachers every corner in every city. But where are the true students of the path? And where are the people who have the guts to face their own shadow, let them come to the surface and work with it, absorb them, dissolve them, embrace them? So we are on a time of a radical and very quick healing. I see the difference from this formal time where it took us years and years of practice, believing kriyas will change my life. Of course, they will change your energy immediately. But then you see the result 20 years later, that the same block, people are in the same cycle, doing the same mistake, nothing changed. So the first realization is kriya are not the solution. The solution is you. You create the problem, you create the solution. And you use kriya with your awareness to transform the energy. If there is no awareness, kriya are useless. You can practice unconsciously and believing just stretching the body will make you good. Definitely will make you good, but it will not solve your life problem. You will not live happily if you just practice. It's like any sort of sport then. You don't put your consciousness in action, then the prana that you move even through a kriya will not be enough. So for us, it's fundamental to work in a group consciousness, in a mentoring group, a mirror group, where you realize, you identify the core energy that is corrupt, that we call trauma. A trauma is a crystallized energy in one of your seven body of energy that you just can't get rid of and that perpetuate your suffering. So if you want to be happy life, it is not a time to escape from that and pretend I'm doing good yoga, so now it's well. It will be well for 1 year, 6 months, and then you go back to the same place. We need to face our traumatic history. And this is 2000 years of history transferred to us through generation and through past life. We are an amazing humanity that is ready to mutate. That means to free ourselves from this long history of darkness. And time is now to bring the light in our life. And that's the priority. It's the first duty you have to give yourself is open the door of your dark side, of your shadows, of your trauma. Share honestly, be visible, yeah, be naked together to each other. And from love and understanding, have people listening. All we need is a qualified audience that can listen to you fully, with no yes but, with no judgment, with no morality. You know, you just who you are, and you share who you are openly. And just this will open the door for self-healing. When we do this mutually, it's a complete miracle that happens. So this is the option of Amritam. The structure is only mentoring group on multi-level. It's very simple. There's no control, there's no check and balance. You just are honestly there in the new spirit of the new human, sitting honestly and sharing honestly what is your priority, where do you block yourself, what is the resistance you see in your life, and start to realize, embrace your shadows, and heal yourself and heal the world. And then you go in more level of capacity to share your realization with others. Because if we get better, it's not only for ourselves, but if we get more ease, and if we get more peace, and if we get more joy in our life, it's not to hold it in a box, it's to share it with others. And therefore you move into this place where you find a new job, which is not a formal job, is a job to share your unique talent as a soul. And this is the shift of humanity. We are not here for producing, we are here to share this amazing quality of your unique soul. So there is so much to explore. I mean, life is going to change radically, radically. All value system is going to be upside down, and we're going to meet finally as human. So start now. Whenever you can, connect to some other people, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10. Have a meeting of honest sharing, you know. Meet each other and share and support each other from the heart, from your own level of realization. If masters are not here, we attract the master's presence as soon as we are more than 5 people around the table. But not to drink wine and smoke dope and finish in the, but it is to share the joy to grow in freedom, to grow in unlimited self, and to share that human quality of not being limited. So the school Amritnam Sarova is also stepping in a creation process where we are giving a frame to this mental group. And there will be this sort of from a simple student in the class becoming eventually a teacher in the class, and eventually becoming a trainer of teachers, if this is your destiny. But there are many other ways. It's not the only axis. There is so many axes for the soul to manifest as a guide, as a healer, intuitive person who can really bring enlightenment and share the vision. There's so many ways we can interact with each other and work with each other from the soul perspective. And it is so needed. So This is for me the just came since yesterday. I presented the change and the radical change from where we were before, coming from Kundalini taught as Yogi Bhajan, and now we are teaching Kundalini free. Is a Kundalini updated, is Kundalini of now, and we take full responsibility to transfer our experience in our full qualification, because we are qualified. So this is where we go, and this is what we want to create. So we're going to present it in a new website. I think before the end of the year, this will be done, and you will have access to all what we have to offer. In terms of experience, we mostly orient our teaching through offering experience, a frame for experience. So we connect also everyone to what we call Dharma. We understand that everyone is not necessarily here for walking the path of mastery, which is extreme demanding. And this is a certain soul have chosen the path of mastery, not everyone. And others, many others, many more people are choosing the path of experience. They come back here and again to have an experience about life, to understand a specific angle, to solve a specific limitation. And this is good enough. I think we are not asking people, we all have to become master. We can master our destiny by embracing the destiny of our soul and not pretending we are somebody else. So the first thing is be authentic, be in resonance with the longing of your soul, and don't try to be somebody else. Now, this is very essential. So Dharma is what? It is not putting a turban on your head or putting the saffron robe or wearing white day and night and so on. You know, the Dharma is following laws. There are universal laws that frame the universe. And as I say before, it's a perfect clock. Everything is in balance and harmony, ruled by universal laws, the law of truth. What is true yesterday, is true today, and will be true tomorrow. All there is in this universe is totally true. But we are off. We are distorted truth. So we need to come back to that essence. So here we are, following the discovering the law of universe. We have basically 12 fundamental laws, but there are more. But these laws, they are inflexible. They're like a sword. They function so precisely that if you try to bend them, you're gonna get a boomerang effect. Yeah, you're gonna be catapulted. So, and that's what happened in our life. We're not honoring the basic law of universe, and therefore we are suffering. So for all those who are here for an experience of life and learning, first thing is to learn about these laws, how they function, and try to obey to this law. And that's what we call Dharma. Dharma doesn't have to be a religion. And I guess in the time we are now, the formal religion were based on a good intention. They wanted to embark to bring many more people into a conscious living, but by forcing laws on people, today we have grown in awareness, and the human being is much more mature. The soul who are coming now are much more mature than 2000 years ago. So the expression, the religiosity, the expression of religion is going to be much more obsolete. The religion is each one of us need to rely on each other. Yeah, that's the religion, is create a relationship with others and be concerned by us more than by me. And this is very basic principle. And then the law of resonance, you become aware of yourself, the law of truth, of love, of compassion and forgiveness. This we have totally misunderstood. We need to bring this into actualization. How can we practically forgive It is not just something in the mind. You hurt me, yes, I must love you, so I forgive you, but then you still live with the anger in your stomach. So this is not. Now, forgiveness is a healing process. Is you give away, enormous amount of energy that was killing you, that was self-destructive, and you just give it out. You give it out, you give it away, you abandon that. This is a work. It doesn't happen because you understand through the mind. You have to work through the body. You have to work emotionally. You have to free these other bodies of energy. So building our body of light, the rainbow body we call, start when you forget to worry about yourself, to be anxious about yourself. You're totally in the wind of trust and unconditional love. And you start to share this joy and love and peace with others. So then you build this light body and you identify yourself with the light you are. You become a beacon, like it's a lighthouse, a source of inspiration for others. So time is now to embody that quality of who you really are and choose to honor that and to recognize in each other the same. The other one is exactly who you are, is total reflection. If you express the light, he will resonate with the light. And then we propagate this wave around the planet. So our school is getting a frame, and this is a start for the next, I hope 20 years. And we will recognize each other, and we will continue to spread the teaching in a very strict way, and not conservative, but evolutive. We are rooted in the changes, and we want to serve the changes. So this is our position, is very, very clear. So you are all welcome. It's a school that is welcoming anybody with his own level of intentionality. We're not gonna make you change your intention. We're gonna reinforce your capacity to stand for your intention. So I think it's not really a change in the school in terms of changing form, but it's formalizing the change and give it a frame so we can carry on in more precise order and with more discipline. So this is what we do for ourselves. The other part beside the school is the ashram here. By a great chance, 1.5 years ago, I had to stop traveling because of this COVID story, but it made me discover this place here around the Le Martinet ashram. That was a place we were mostly using for workshop, and I have dedicated a lot of work into building facilities. So this is all built now, and now we have started the permaculture in the garden, and this is attracting people, a new generation. They can live here, they can feed themselves, they can take care of the land, and they discover the practice of Kundalini yoga and spiritual practice on a daily basis. So we have an ongoing sadhana, and we have a life. And finally, I realized I have a life here on this planet. I was just on suitcase and traveling. So now it's 1.5 years. I'm not traveling at all. I have a life here. I root myself. So this is another exalting adventure to grow together as a group consciousness with putting in practice all the teaching. So I think this is a showing the alchemy has to be these two parts. You know, one, you develop self-awareness among a group of human beings that can be honest and truthful to each other. And the second is you start an operation, you start an action, a project, something where you put your consciousness, and that's the alchemy. You need to produce something in the matter that your spirit will create, that is in harmony. And then what you create will represent that image of the self in expansion. So alchemy, as always, these two sides is transform the matter or the lead into gold, or using elixir or healing mixture to transform the nature of your spirit. And then you transform the matter. So it's a back and forth between you, your action, and the result of your action, elevating your spirit. So this is the alchemy we're practicing, and I think we invite everybody to do so, that grow your spirit and be engaged into action in the world. So you're going to be aware of your impact and how much light you can bring into the world and into yourself. So my prayer is that you have that strength and discipline to keep yourself in this high frequency of extremely blissful and peaceful stage. And for that, I have planned three practices, so we're going to do it now. Usually it's around pranayama, that's the choice I made, that because the rhythm of your breath, and we are actually the breath of God. God is breathing through us. Yeah? So more we become aware of this breath and we can impact our breath, that breath will impact our life. So the first thing we need to do is, like usual, you know, activate your nabi, activate the navel. And in Kundalini, we have this beautiful breath of fire that is a key. I mean, we could do only 31 minutes of this a few times a day and it changed your whole life. So pulsing the navel is a key. That's where the whole Kundalini is, in the cave, in the Merudan, in the base of your navel, in the back, and ready to come down and up through Sushumna. So how to bring together this solar and lunar energy through the pulse of the navel. So the navel will be pulsing quick, like you all know about the breath of fire, but we're gonna do it a little bit more powerful, not just superficial, a little bit more pushy. So really moving your navel consciously, and we're gonna move our arms slowly. So the arms is pointing your index finger and locking the other finger with the thumb. We open the arms and then we cross them above, and we open again and we cross them below. So I say crisscross, one time above, one time below. And this movement is not fast. We don't want to do it fast. We want to do it consciously, slowly, with all the energy that it moves through the Jupiter finger. It should be very stiff. The finger is very tense and stretched. And the arm goes slow, but the breath is through the nose, powerful, through the navel. So here we go. I will put music for you. And it's going to be about 8 minutes. So close your eyes and we go for it. Start the breath of fire, pulsing powerfully. your divine self. Welcome the connection to the divine. Yeah? Open up and bring it into your arms. Yeah? Oh, Inhale deep. Open your arms and connect to this center of love, center of peace, and center of bliss. This little happy child inside you. Inhale more. Smile and let go. We just finished the Brahm Kavach, which was 40 hours meditation around the fire in our geodesic dome. We had about 60 people participant. The energy was fabulous. So we just finished this celebration of the solstice and of the equinox, sorry. And I invite you to do something like this. Just invite people and just do a japa. Can be Mool Mantra, any mantra you are favorite with, and then spend 2 hours and a half together just celebrating and reconnecting to this inner joy. This was so much fire and so much peace at the end. Wonderful day. Through the rain, the fire didn't capitulate. So water and fire were together, united. We got amazing storm that was so much blessing. So it's a relief. It's a moment of relieving. And I wanted to do this with the Saresasa. We're not going to use the mantra for expressing loud. We have it in silence. But maybe you know this meditation where we put our hands in a cup with the both hands and we bring them down in our lap and take the water of washing all our fear, anxiety, anger, frustration. So we inhale through the mouth. We're going to do a breath instead of repeating the mantra. The mantra is in our mind in silence, but we go with the breath and we inhale through the mouth, fully inhaling, full capacity, where you bring your hands above your head. And then from there, you bring the back of your hand together, and then you exhale through the mouth. Like a total relief. You drop all tension, all anxiety, all fear, all anger. And again, you take from the water of your shadow. It's like you're drowning, you're losing yourself, you're losing references, you lose your system, you lose everything. You go, and then you exhale and total let go, total let go. It's all through the mouth, inhaling full capacity with your cap, and let it dive down. You understand? It is slow. Again, it is very peaceful. It's a deep, deep breath in through the mouth. As much as you can fill up all capacity, you can do it by step as well. And you can exhale slowly and fully. Here we go. This will be 11 minutes. Sarang, you are up and you go down. Arare, arare. Fully exhale down. And again. Inhale, sare, sasa. Sarang. Sa 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 re sa 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 re sa 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 ram. New beginning, new freshness. Purify yourself and release anger, anxiety. Drop it. You come out of the waters. You're not going to drown.
Hare 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 Hare
Inhale. And exhale. Be aware of the alignment of your spine and the freedom in your chest, in your stomach. You don't need to carry anything, shoulders are light. You're open to this peaceful stage. And now we fill up this peace, this empty space with bliss, with Ananda. And that's the purpose of the last part of this Kriya, is combine peace of mind and peace of energy that we brought together in Sushumna. Now we're going to expand it in the whole universe. And this is a Laya practice, which is a pulsing of Kundalini with the mantra of ecstasy, which is Vaheguru. We're going to move our head, so we're going to bring the left palm on the thymus chakra. This is in between throat and heart. The left palm on the thymus and the right on the heart center, just underneath. So that means you connect unconditional love to yourself and then to everyone. And we're going to go twisting the head left and right. Vaheguru, 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 Vahe Vahe Vaheguru, 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 Vahe Vahe Vaheguru. So this is the mantra, and the music is a total Om, universal Om. So it's just expanding the space to infinity. So we're gonna create the rhythm together. We start from the left side. So the left palm on the thymus, the right palm on the heart center. Inhale to begin. Here we go. Close your eyes and connect the heart and the third eye and just expand to infinity. Vaheguru, Vaheguru, Vahe Vahe Vaheguru, 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 Vahe Vahe Vaheguru. Let your whole body move with your head and just move, move, move. Vaheguru, Vaheguru, Vahe Vahe Vaheguru, 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 Vahe Vahe Vaheguru. Lose yourself and go, go for it. Expand, expand, expand. Vaheguru, Vaheguru, Vahe, Vahe, Vaheguru, 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 Vaheguru. Inhale deep. Inhale more. And just see all what you can give birth to create the new human you are. All the beauty you can generate, all the beautiful action you can start, everything you can initiate, innovate. Just see the path before you opening with light, joy, bliss, and exhale. So now if you observe your frequency, this is the beginning of being high frequency. You are in peace and you are in bliss. So this is what you need to cultivate. And I guess if you do this every day, you to start the day, you bring this into your day. So I wish you blissful and peaceful days for the next months. We're gonna open the workshop on the healing sound from the 10 October to the 16th. So there are still people can come and join. And we'll do this retreat, Ayurvedic and healing retreat in November, December. And we'll have our 12 night to pass the year into the new year. So anticipating excellent changes into your life. I bless you all and bring peace in your surrounding, above you, below you, in front of you, in the back of you, and everywhere. Sat Nam. Thank you for being here. Love you all. Thank you for your prayer, and let's spread this all over the planet. Bye-bye. Asvidan. Tschüss. Paka, paka.